Even this week also, somehow I could not go to any other topic, and my mind and my heart still drawn to the church again, and because that's the heart of God, you know, because God is really waiting for the church to get ready, and the church is His body, and church is His bride, and He's coming for His bride again, and He wants us to be ready for that. And I believe that, you know, His coming is very soon. And I believe that He wanted us to be prepared for the rapture, you know. And He's coming for a spotless, without wrinkle, for that church is coming back, you know. So we have to be ready, and we have to know what church means. We have to have proper understanding about that. You know, Ephesians chapter 3 verse 10. Let's see Amplified version today, the whole time we are going to see Amplified version. Because it's very nicely explained. Ephesians chapter 3 verse 10. The purpose is that through the church, the complicated, many-sided wisdom of God in all its infinite variety and innumerable aspects might now be made known to the angelic rulers and authorities, means principalities and powers in the heavenly sphere. Hallelujah. You know, see, God wants to release that wisdom into this world through the church. And God wants the church to let these rulers know what God has prepared. Hallelujah. That the wisdom of is very big word. That is, wisdom means it's just not the simple thing. That is, you know, it means if whatever the enemy messed up and made things upside down in this world, God has a strategy to fix it back.
Amen.
Hallelujah. For everything, I'm telling you, every crisis in this world, every problem in this world, solution is there in the church. Solution is available for the whole world, that's in the church itself. Hallelujah.
Amen.
God put that solution in the church, beloved. That's what it's saying. At the end days, the enemy will rise up and do things so like a messy things go wrong in the world, and people look for peace, and terrorism increases and killings increases. Everything, there won't be enough food and water, no money, economically, everything goes down. But you know what? God kept answer for this whole world in the church.
Amen.
Hallelujah. That's why there's a prophecy also in the end days, even the rulers of this world, even the rulers, they come to the church for wisdom. Because wisdom is available in the church. God knows how to fix every problem. You know, in the time of Daniel, right? Joseph time. When God revealed to Joseph ahead of time, what is about to come? There's a famine is about to hit the world. At that time, God revealed it to Joseph. You know, that's what it is. God given gifts to the church, to the body of Christ. Through the gifting, we will come to know beforehand anything what's going to happen.
Amen, amen.
So, enemy cannot escape from us. Nothing can be hidden from the church. Everything is revealed to the church. So Joseph came to know what is going to come. And then what happened? God again given wisdom to Joseph how to fix it. When the famine comes, what to do? The wisdom is given to Joseph. So he shared to the king. So they did accordingly. What happened? The whole world, all nations came to Egypt for food, because of Joseph's strategy. Hallelujah. That's it. You know, everything what happened in the Old Testament, it's a prophetically happened. It means that's what going to happen in the days to come. Everything. what is being said, Old Testament, is a prophecy. In the days to come, what's going to happen? You know, so the same way, whatever the problem the world has, God gives wisdom to the body of Christ. Mm-hmm. That's why the gifts are there. You know, did you see the word? Gifts are for the body. Gifts of the Holy Spirit belong to the body, belong to the church. That's why when people are connected to the church, beloved, that's when they're able to move in the gifts powerfully. Sometimes, you know, we see gifts more, but we don't pay attention to connecting to the body of Christ. But gifts are given to the body for the edification of the body. There is a purpose why God gave gifts, for the edification purpose. So when we are connected to the body of Christ, gifts are available and we will become sharpened in us. We can move in the power of God. We can move in the giftings. Hallelujah. You know, God said, Matthew chapter 16 verse 18, on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not overcome it. In the Amplified version, what it is? I tell you, you are Peter, a large piece of rock, and on this rock, Greek, Petra, huge rock like Gibraltar, I will build my church, and the gates of Hades, it means the powers of the infernal region, shall not overpower it or be strong to its detriment or hold out against it. So, it means, when did he say this word? When Jesus, before even he crucified on the cross, anything happened before only he revealed this, the purpose, the plan, what he had, the strategy, what he had, he revealed it to Peter. See, it means the Father and Son, they know what they want to do. So the whole point of Jesus coming and receiving authority from the Father and giving that, they're planning that. Afterwards, what's going to happen? That authority should remain here, because that's the purpose why he wanted to receive authority from the Father. That authority need to remain here in this world. That's why they're planning church. Hallelujah. Before anything happened. See, God already has in his mind that he's going to build his church, and that authority can be given to the church. That's why he's saying, did you see that? I will build my church, so the gates of hell, whatever the enemy, whatever the whole camp of the enemy, hell means what? The whole camp cannot stand again the church.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Why? Because authority, what I received from my Father, I'm going to give that authority to the church. And I go.
Hallelujah.
The whole demonic thing, whole, come against the church, they cannot stand. Hallelujah. So, and then after verse 19, I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind, declared to be improper and unlawful on earth, must be what is already bound in heaven. And whatever you loose, declared lawful on earth, must be what is already loosed in heaven. Did you see that? Heaven is already bound the works of the enemy. But heaven is waiting. Heaven is waiting for a man to stand here. Actually, heaven is waiting for the church to stand here and just bind and loose, because heaven is already did it. Heaven bound the enemy, bound the works of the enemy. Heaven already loosed blessings over the earth. But the thing is that somebody has to open, somebody has to access it. Who? Church. So when he's saying, I will give you the keys of kingdom of heaven, means he's not talking about to one individual he's giving the keys. He's, because what context he was saying in the previous, church. So he wants to give the keys to the church. The church will be able to release blessings from heaven. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
If this earth wants to be blessed, who can do that? Who has the authority to release blessings from heaven? Church has the authority to release blessings of heaven to this earth.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. And if the world is really terrified by the enemy and tormented and destroyed by the enemy, who has the power to bind the enemy?
Amen. The church.
Church has the power to bind the enemy. Hallelujah. Did you see, beloved, what we possess? What is the importance of church? What we possess today? Hallelujah. Never take church lightly. We must get connect to each other. We must become a body of Christ. It's church is not only the body of Christ, and also it speaks about the army of God. Church is also army of God. Who is the head of the army?
Jesus Christ.
And that's why Apostle Paul talked about Christians considered as the soldiers of Jesus Christ. Why? Because army we are. So we are all considered as soldiers of Jesus Christ. So every person who joined the army, they have a purpose. What is the purpose of army? To go again, to go into the war. Army purpose is, they're getting trained, that's all. Some are still getting trained. But the ultimate goal is to go against another kingdom. You understand? Christians cannot take, just relax and rest, beloved. God is calling us to go against the enemy. To go against the enemy. Maybe you're taking time to get trained. But ultimately, that is the job of every Christian. That is God expecting from us. Become soldiers of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Be a soldier of Jesus Christ. Because see, rest we can take there. After going there, we can have rest. But as long as we live on this earth, we have to be on the battlefield.
Amen.
Keep fighting. If that is the only way for us to be protected from the enemy. If you keep fighting, if you are in the army, you are safe. Do you understand? Christians will be safe if you are in the army. Join the army of God. If you join the army of God, you are not alone.
Amen.
You are not alone. The whole army is with you. The main thing, the head of the army, Jesus Christ, is going to be with you. Right? That is the only place we can have rest. We can have protection. If you are not in the army, we become victims. Satan do not spare anybody. He's not going to spare anybody. Equally, he attacks every person, whether he's in the army or outside the army. Every Christian who accepts Christ, Satan is not going to leave them. So what's the point of being separated? Just get into army then. Join the army. You have protection. So keep fighting. Keep fighting the battle. If you keep fighting the enemy, we are putting enemy busy on run. If we give him time, he will come back and attack us. We should put enemy all the time defensive side. He should always take care of his defense, how to protect himself, so that he do not have time to attack us back. He always has to think how to protect himself, beloved. We have to put the enemy in that condition. We are the one should be go against the enemy, attacking. Instead of Satan coming and attacking us, we need to go first and attack. Keep attacking. That is the only way we can be free from attacks. Hallelujah. If we keep attacking, enemy is on the run, just to think about his protection instead of he coming and attacking. If we are relaxing, not attacking, not fighting, that's the problem. Then we have problems. Hallelujah. Right? Okay. And then, what is Thursday praise will do? Attacking the enemy. That's what. The Thursday praise, you know, is a warfare prayer. That we are all coming as a body. We're gathering as an army. And we are going against the enemy every Thursday. Every Thursday. How much we go against and destroy the works of the enemy, you can see the fruit of it throughout your week. Throughout the week. Today, what is happening today is the result of Thursday prayer.
Amen.
You understand? If Thursday prayers are really powerful, Sunday service will be powerful. Not only that, your week will go powerful. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So, and then, okay, next is, when we are in the body of Christ, what else is going to happen? When we are, Psalms chapter 133, verse 2. It is like the precious ointment poured on the head that ran down on the beard, even the beard of Aaron, the first high priest, that came down upon the collar and skirts of his garments, consecrating the whole body. Remember that. Consecrating the whole body. It's a prophetically said pillar. In the Old Testament, God told Moses, anoint Aaron. Aaron is a priest. Anoint Aaron, but pour out oil from the head, on the head. You know, that's a pictorial thing. It's a symbolic of, is a body of Christ. And the anointing is coming from where? From the head. Hallelujah. The anointing comes from the head. And therefore, it flows to the whole, consecrating the whole body. So, if you are in the body, what do you receive? Anointing. What do you receive? Anointing. Anointing is the supernatural power of God.
Amen.
You will be able to bring supernatural things upon this earth, that with the power of God, you know, that's the anointing. You move in the power, you move in the authority. Hallelujah. So, anointing is going to come when you attach to the body of Christ. Hallelujah. And then, and the other thing, when we are saved, many people, they're baptized yesterday, you know, for them also, it's really used for them to know this is very useful. When you are a young believer, joined, you know, what God wants all of us to be mentored. You know why? Because God is actually looking for disciples. That's what he said to disciples. You know, what did he say? Let's see that Matthew... Chapter 28, verse 19 and 20. Matthew chapter 28, verse 19 and 20. Go then and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them into the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything that I have commanded. Hallelujah. And behold, I am with you all the days. God wants every person to be discipled. You know why? Because when we are discipled, because He wants to use us. That's the main thing. When we are discipled, we will become useful. We become useful to God. God, that's the main purpose why God delivered you, why God saved you, because He has a purpose in your life. He wants to use you. All of us, He wants to use us. You know, through us, He wants to save many people around us. Through us, He wants to set people free. So that's why God is interested. God wants us to be discipled so that He would be able to use us. So, and that's what I'm calling mentoring. Before, when we are in the army, before we go against another kingdom, first of all, we have to overcome the battles that is against our soul, our own soul. It's coming against our own soul. First overcome that battle. Then we can go against the bigger battle. We can go into bigger battles. Hallelujah. First the battle is what is coming against you. Overcome that battle first. You know, so that's going to be helped in mentoring program. When people join, like want to be mentored, if someone is mentoring them, in that mentoring time, all those things will be, you know, God is going to set all those things. Even in the Old Testament, right? When Solomon wants to build the temple, and all the stones were brought in. Do you see that? All the stones were brought in before they build the temple. Brought together. All the stones. So then the stone cutters will come. And then they take the stone and they shape the stone according to the place where they need to go. According to the requirement where he wants to put in. And accordingly he shaped the stone and take and put it in. That's the symbolic of church. You know, people coming together is a church, beloved. Like this kind of setup, right? When so many, it means stones brought. Stones were brought into the house. Stones were collected and brought in here. But what we need to do with these stones? We are the living stones. That's what Apostle Paul mentioned. We are the living stones in his house, right? Okay. The stones were brought in. Then God wants to take the stone and cut it. Because He knows what calling God has given to them. According to that, God wants to shape them through someone in our life. They are called mentors, whoever they are, right? And place them in their positions. Hallelujah. That's what is about. Putting them to the body of Christ. Before connecting to the body, first He will do cutting thing, shaping us, and then we are ready for a battles. Then He'll put it, connect that. Never stop in that stage. You know, we need to have the desire, I want to be mentored, Lord. I want to be in the army of God. I want to be the part of the body of Christ. I need mentoring, Lord. I want, Lord. I'm willing, Lord. God is going to do that. And you know, what happens in the mentoring program, and so many things I will tell you, what benefits it you is that many times, like when you start opening up to someone, right? When you start sharing your problems or your issues or your weak points, and you know, there's something secret I'll tell you. When you start opening up, enemy loses his power over your life. Reason is, when you start exposing the works of the enemy loses power over our lives. Otherwise, enemy speaks to people's minds saying that, oh, you are the only one you have problems. You are the only one you have all issues. You're the only bad person here. You're the only one who have all sins in your life. That is the biggest lie of the enemy, beloved. Never believe that that's a lie. Because the word says, not only you around, look around, everybody has same problems. Everybody have issues. Everybody have weak points. Everybody have sinful desires. Not only you. That is the great lie of the enemy. You will come to realize only after you open up. When you start sharing to your mentors, you know, your mentor is going to tell you, oh, don't worry, I also gone through it. I also experienced the same thing. That's what it is. You know what? Devil is going to lie those things and then tell us that nobody is like you. You're so bad. And like, he'll put us into condemnation. That's why I have seen many Christians suffering with condemnation. And not only, like, you know, he'll put us into shame. Always we feel guilty and very shameful to come into the presence of God. We feel low about ourselves. That is a big barrier for us to receive blessings from God. When we are condemned, we cannot receive blessings. Hallelujah. Do you know something? God's love is so great. And He never condemns us. Because He actually sees us like His image is in us. God created us in His own image. But what happened? Enemy messed us up and brought us so low and putting all the dirt and garbage in our lives. But God is not going to look at that garbage, because that's the work of the enemy. Who cares? God knows how to bring us back. Hallelujah. God only sees that what He put inside of us. He put His image.
Amen. Amen.
Do you understand? God put His image in us. God is only looking at that. God is only interested to bring that out.
Amen.
What the rest garbage, what enemy made in our lives, God overlooked that and bring this image in us.
Hallelujah.
That's great, the love of God into our life, beloved. That's why Apostle Paul said, just be rooted in the love of Christ and know how long His love is, how wide and how, you know, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 18 and 19. That you may have the power and be strong to apprehend and grasp with all the saints, devoted people, the experience of that love. What is the breadth and the length and height and depth of it? That you may really come to know practically through experience for yourselves the love of Christ, which far surpasses mere knowledge, without experience, that you may be filled through all your being unto the fullness of God, may have the richest measure of the divine presence and become a body wholly filled and flooded with God Himself. Hallelujah. This, you know, I really am realizing since 2 days, God is. And we only, we think that, oh, I have problem, I have to pray now, I have to go to somebody, I have to cry out. And I suddenly realized that God is waiting to heal you, to bless you. You don't need to worry about it. God already saw it. God already knows it. And He wants to bless you. He wants to pull you out of the problem. You just have to say one word, Lord, come. Lord, do this for me. Just one word, beloved, God is ready to hear your prayer. He loves you. He loves us. I know when we are singing that song, the glory all around, shine your glory all around. You know what? We were actually belong to glory. We belong to glory of God.
Amen.
Adam fell from the glory. God restored that glory back through Jesus. We belong there. Our character is a Christ character. Our nature is Christ nature. We fell from there. And God is so eager to take us back there. He's so eager. He's waiting for us to go back to the glory again, beloved. That's why cooperate with God. Cooperate with God. Don't look to the mess and discourage right now. Don't look to the mess. Don't look to the garbage. God gives you enough grace. Hallelujah. You think that, Lord, I have this problem. I have this weakness. I'm struggling. Doesn't matter, beloved. God is able.
Amen.
God is able.
Amen.
And He gives you grace. That grace is enough. That grace is enough for you to come out from your problems.
Hallelujah.
Come out from your weak points.
Amen.
The grace of God. Do you know how long, how high the grace? That is enough to you, for you to come to the glory again.
Amen.
He will lift you up again. Hallelujah. And just these things, you know, they will tell you, they will help you how to overcome your battles, how to come out from your problems, from your condemnation, from your guilt. All this will be, you can learn in the mentoring. Because mentoring is also, you're exposing and you're accountable to somebody and they help you out. Then we can connect to the army of God. We can connect to the body of Christ. Hallelujah. So even though you are still in the mentoring program, you are not away from Christ. You are under the leadership of somebody's authority. You are safe and you are protected. Whoever is mentoring you, you are under their authority, beloved. Hallelujah. And then, so this is for the new believers. And the believers who already got connected to the body of Christ, for them also God has given us a word. You know, what connected us to the body of Christ is, you know, actually another thing I'll tell you, in the mentoring time, you will come to know your calling. That's how your calling will be exposed during mentoring. You know, how as you are coming out from your shortcomings, your failures, and as you're walking into humility. You know what? Another very important thing is humility. Humility. Because what actually acts as a barrier is pride. Pride is a big barrier. You know, God is okay. Even we have problems, we have weaknesses, we have, okay, all anger issues, all whatever the sin is, we are struggling. You know what? God is okay with all that. God has no problem with all that issues because he has ability, he has power to rescue us from all that, and he gives us grace to come out of all that. No problem. The problem is that pride. Problem is pride. Because God is not able to reach people because of the pride what we put up before God. Is that, you know, because the word says the pride belongs to Satan. That's the nature of Satan. That's the nature of enemy. Whatever, the very first thing God deals when we come to Him, God deals with us. Start removing pride from us. He wants to remove pride from us. That's why in the mentoring time, it really helps you, because to be mentored by somebody, to receive somebody giving us direction, to receive somebody giving us counseling, that needs humility. That needs humility. That's the time God works on our pride. Start pulling the pride. away from us. You know the reason why Lucifer fell down? Pride. That's the nature of enemy. He put his nature in human beings. God started dealing with that pride. You know, in the word says, he opposes, let's see the word of Peter, right? Peter, can somebody please quickly open it? First Peter or Second Peter? Is the end region. Yeah. Likewise, you who are younger and of lesser rank, be subject to the elders, the ministers, and the spiritual guides of the church, giving them due respect and yielding to their counsel. Clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility as the garb of a servant, so that its covering cannot possibly be stripped from you, with freedom from pride and arrogance toward one another. For God sets himself against the proud, the insolent, the overbearing, disdainful, presumptuous, he explained what is pride means. Presumptuous, the boastful, and he opposes, frustrates and defeats them, but gives grace to the humble. Hallelujah. He gives grace to the humble. That's what it says. It's okay, even so many weak points, we have no need to feel ashamed of anything. He gives us grace. He pulls us out. But what really coming in between is the pride. God opposes the pride. He cannot reach people because of the pride. The pride is explained what it is. You know, the here, like what is you who are younger and of lesser rank, be subject to the elders. It means young believers, you know, newcomers. The ministers and spiritual guides of the church, giving them due respect and yielding to their counsel, and clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility as the garb of a servant, so that its covering cannot be possibly be stripped from you, with freedom from pride and arrogance toward one another. For God sets himself against the proud, the insolent, the overbearing, disdainful. It means insolent, pride, overbearing, like dominating, and disdainful, disrespectful, you know, not lack of respect, and presumptuous. What do you say? Thoughts? Yeah. Thinking before only the boastful, and he opposes, frustrates, and defeats them, but gives grace to the humble. Hallelujah. So, this is the only thing we need to be careful, and then to show that we are humble, then we can go and take mentoring, be mentored by someone. That itself shows that we are humbling ourselves. Hallelujah. And then, you know, and then God is going to shape us and bring us to the, and then our callings are going to be exposed in the mentoring time. I don't know, when we start obeying God every day, little by little, you will come to know, oh, I think God is calling me to do that. Like that, little by little, you will start seeing the plan of God upon your life. You start feeling that burden inside. I think God is calling me for young people. I think God is calling me for children, because I'm feeling burden for them. You know, I think God is calling me for orphanage. You know, God is calling me for this kind of people. Oh, for these broken homes. Oh, for broken marriages. Who are in addictions. Like this, like you start feeling inside. That's how God is revealing to you your callings. Hallelujah. Once that has been revealed to you, not only you, even the one who is mentoring you will come to know what your calling is. God even speaks to them. But once a person is opened up to God, then God begins to reveal his plan upon their lives. And mentors will come to know, church pastors will come to know, and that's how they can even bring prophecies over your life. They prophesy over you, the callings upon your life. That's how, beloved, everything will surface up. Everything will come into light. Hallelujah. That's what, once a person realizes that God called me, it means you need to respond to that call of God. We can't just say, God called me and just be relaxed about it. No. When you feel God is calling you for something, you should respond to that call. How do you respond to the call of God? You do something about it. What do? You go to somebody, you go to a pastor, you tell the pastor, Pastor, give me some work. Do you want me to help you with something? I want to join. I want to help you. What? I want to give hand in anything because I know God called me for this. Can you train me in the calling? Something, beloved. You can't be quiet. You can't be quiet. God even started giving you direction what to do about it. For me like that, when God told me that, I will use you to the ends of the earth for many nations. I can't sit at home. That really made me restless till I do something about it. I asked God, Lord, what do I do? Where do I go? Who can train me? How it's going to happen? Then God told me that, connect to system here. God gives you direction what to do. God definitely connects you with somebody. Go and talk to somebody. Go to the pastor. Tell the pastor. Like that. God will lead you to the right place. Hallelujah. That's how you will join the body of Christ. Hallelujah. And then we need to be established in the love of Christ. Okay, go back. Ephesians chapter 3 verse 18 and 19. About the love of Christ I'm talking. We need to be established in the love of Christ. When you are in the body of Christ, when you are connected to the body of Christ, beloved, never lose focus. Your focus, why you are there? Because God wants to use you to set people free from their bondages, from the enemy. Never lose focus. You know, today we are doing, as a church, we are doing so many things as a church. You know that what we are doing. Everybody, we distribute the work among ourselves because we don't want anybody to be overburdened with all the work, right? When you are working together, when you are coming together and to make this day successful, for example, Sunday service, to make Sunday service successful, what we do? We are all distributing the work among us equally so that everything would go smoothly on that day. So like that, every special meeting, every event we have in the church, we are distributing that work among ourselves. But don't think that is the primary focus, beloved. That is only for that day to go smoothly, we are organizing ourselves. But the main focus for our primary focus for every believer is God has a calling upon your life and you are a blessing to many people. And through you, the authority, through your authority, many people are going to be set free from the enemy. Never lose that focus. Even though you are working in the church, doing all these activities, but that's not your primary goal. Your primary goal is souls. 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 You know what? Stephen, right? When Stephen, Apostle Peter, the disciples, what they said is, okay, select some men among you who are God-fearing and who are full of spirit and who have a good character, who has a good name, select them and bring them to us. So it means, I'm sure the Stephen was maybe added to the church when at the time 3,000 people baptized. Maybe that's the time Stephen and Philip were also added to the church. They heard the gospel and they baptized and they started coming to the church. But what were they doing all that time? Till he was appointed, Stephen, what were they doing all that time? What were they doing is, the word says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teachings and to the word and to the prayer and to the communion and fellowship of the believers. So they were very faithful, coming regularly and growing in the Lord. Then people saw that. People saw these people are genuine. They're obedient. They're God-fearing. They're full of spirit. They're growing. They saw it and they brought them to apostles. And then that's what I'm telling. When you first do something, mentoring and do all that, when you start growing in the character, and they were brought to the apostles, and apostles laid hand upon them, and they were connected to the body. They're given some responsibility in the church to take care of the tables. But do you think that Stephen was primary goal is only serving tables? No. His focus was put on winning souls. Stephen was doing the job in the church, but he was also preaching the gospel. And he was doing miracles, praying for the sick. That was his call. That was the call. That's what, beloved, every person must do that. Your primary focus, even though you're doing things in the church, primary focus is souls. Souls. Through the authority what you're gaining, God is going to set people free. This continuation, next Sunday, I will tell that about more gaining authority. Let's stand. But today, Father, we release the blessings over them. We release every blessing, every financial blessing over them in the name of Jesus. We release healing over their bodies in the name of Jesus. We release restoration to them, to their families, to them, even whatever they lost in the past. We release that restoration in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Tarabababa shikarabala karamandarabalasya. Fill them with your presence, Lord. Fill them with your joy, Father. Fill them, Lord Jesus. Rabababa shikarabala karamandara babababa. Tarabala, touch everyone. Let's all lift your hands. Lift your hands up and just receive from God. Receive karabala, Holy Spirit, God, touch each one of them. Whatever the desire, whatever the hunger they have today, Father God, you fill them, will satisfy their souls, Father God. Rikaba baba baba shira bala 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 karaba baba 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 tarabala karabala karamandara balasya. You know, God is looking at you. All of you are so precious to Him. And He's seeing His image in you. He's seeing His image in you. Hallelujah. Don't look to yourself present condition, beloved. But God is able to bring you out from every issue, from every problem you have. Hallelujah. You belong to the glory of God. You belong to the glory. Hallelujah. Amen. And God has a calling upon your life. Everyone is so mighty here. Everyone is so precious here. Nobody is less. You know, as we are singing that song, we are the child of God. You just believe that. Believe that you are the children of God. You're not slaves anymore. You're no longer slaves. Can you sing that song? We are no longer slaves anymore. We are the children of God.
Amen.
Just be walk in boldness with confidence. Lift your head up and just and walk in boldness, beloved. You are the children of
Amen.
God. Hallelujah. Because God is not looking at your present condition. Because God is looking at the calling and the whom you are going to become. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.